So if you haven't heard the recent news, Princess Mako, the niece of Emperor Naruhito, the current reigning emperor of Japan, has decided to marry someone outside of royalty, thus causing her to lose her own royal status. In fact, this news is actually several years old by this point, but right now is just resurfacing after her and her fiancé finally have gone forward and at last gotten married. This, of course, under the current laws and rules of the Japanese Imperial household, means that she is now just considered a simple commoner. And from this, we see the rise of two major debates that have erupted regarding this news. One debate outside of Japan, which has been more critical towards the whole idea of the Japanese monarchy, and a debate inside of Japan surrounding the issue of the man she was set to marry, with many being very suspicious of him and his family's past controversies, leading to many believing him to be unfit to marry her. And although this debate is currently a very sensitive one, it is not the one I'm going to talk about here, but rather a larger debate that has been going on for some years regarding the imperial laws of succession and the crisis facing the imperial family. Now, normally, my videos are all about samurai and samurai history, but for this video I'm going to step outside of that zone and talk about these issues, because right now I feel more than ever is a significant time to shed some light on both of these debates, while also helping you better understand the historical role and cultural importance of the Emperor of Japan. But first and foremost, to state the obvious, I'm not Japanese. So, with that said, I'm going to look to cover this topic objectively. This is not some piece of pro-Japanese imperial propaganda, but rather a dive into why the Japanese emperor is such a historically and culturally significant figure, along with some of the important issues currently facing the imperial family in modern day. Yet, I should also add that, of course, this topic is very complicated and at times confusing. I have tried my best to get a grip on some of the finer details, but please, if I make any mistakes, I welcome you to correct me in the comments. So, on that note, let's dive in by first discussing a bit about the history of the Japanese emperor, before then going off to talk about the current controversies. Like most prominent civilizations that have arisen over thousands of years, ancient Japan started out with a form of despotic rule, with the first monarch believed to be Jimmu, a legendary and perhaps even mythological figure who began his reign in 660 BC and is said to have been descended from Amaterasu, the Shinto goddess of the sun. Although his actual existence is largely debated by historians today, Jimmu is also considered to be the first emperor of Japan. Theoretically, this makes the Japanese royal family the oldest surviving monarchy in the world. Because Jimmu was the first, all of his offspring were said to carry the blood of a deity, being all descended from Amaterasu. This is why the Japanese equivalent to the word emperor, Tenno, can roughly be translated to mean heavenly sovereign. This belief has existed for the majority of Japan's existence, that the emperor was godly, and thus was sort of seen as the head of the Shinto faith, creating a figure that is not only as respected as a monarch, but also as worshipped as, say, a pope. This has always carried with the imperial family, as unlike other monarchies across the world, the lineage of the Japanese emperor has always remained within the same overall family. Although it has not always been carried father to son, and instead has from time to time been succeeded through different branches of the family, including brothers, cousins, and nephews. Either way, the figure who occupies the chrysanthemum throne, the seat named after the imperial insignia, has always remained within the same unbroken bloodline that is believed to be descended from Emperor Jimmu. Now, originally, for centuries the emperor and his imperial court ruled Japan. That is until 1185, whereby the end of the extremely significant conflict known as the Genpei War, the samurai took control of the nation and established a form of military government where a shogun, the highest military leader in the land, yet still below the emperor, held essentially more actual power than the emperor. The shogun's government was known as the bakufu, or shogunate. The emperor was still allowed to rule from the imperial capital, Kyoto, but in all actuality he was just a figurehead while the samurai ran the country. Now, the samurai were still theoretically loyal to the emperor, and we can see times when samurai went above and beyond the call of duty in the name of the emperor, But there were also times when emperors tried to rise up and re-establish themselves as the real head of the government, and there were times where they actually briefly succeeded. Yet, in the end, the samurai would dominate Japan for nearly seven centuries, finally coming to fall in 1868, when the final samurai government, the Tokugawa shogunate, was toppled, restoring the emperor to ultimate power. This would usher in the age of Imperial Japan, when the country rapidly modernized and set out for new territorial ambitions across Asia. At the time, the Japanese were poised to emulate European empires. Ruled by a monarchy and with a lust for imperial expansion, Japan even largely westernized in its appearance as to fit in with the styles of Europe. Their aggressive military expansion would finally bring us into the years of the Second World War, where Japan would at last be defeated by the Allies. In the aftermath, the United States was largely responsible for the reshaping of Japanese politics, and was desperate to find a way to declaw the radical militarism that had become deep-rooted in Japan after centuries of samurai rule. And the path for the US was unclear regarding how to handle the issue of the Japanese emperor. The Allies had said that Japan, like Germany, would be forced to suffer an unconditional surrender, yet Japan still held firm to the one condition, that no matter what, there would be no abolition of the emperor or the imperial family. There is plenty of debate still raging to this day regarding how much actual involvement Emperor Hirohito had in pushing Japan into World War II, but in the end, the US realized how important the figure of the emperor was to the Japanese, and thus allowed him to keep his ceremonial position, albeit now he was truly just relegated to being a figurehead once again. And he had to also announce to the Japanese people that he was not actually a deity. We also see by 1947, along with the creation of Japan's new constitution, there would also be a reshaping of the imperial laws of succession. These had followed the Imperial House Law of 1889, which had sought to cut down on the number of possible claimants to the imperial throne, while also helping ensure that only males would ascend to the throne, something that was already pretty much the norm. However, the new 1947 Imperial Household Law can arguably be seen as far more drastic, as it eliminated all other branches of the imperial family other than those who were part of Emperor Hirohito's line and siblings. And although it probably was not recognized at the time, this has caused a number of modern-day problems, including marriages, offspring, and actual succession. Now, I'm going to try to discuss this in a way that is not too overly confusing. So I feel we should start at the top. One of the main issues facing the imperial family today has to do with how it approaches its female members. Under Japanese laws of succession, only males can ascend to the chrysanthemum throne. But additionally, males are also allowed to marry outside of the imperial family, and thus bring in a wife to the imperial family. However, on the flip side of that, daughters within the imperial family have to marry relatives within their extended family in order to stay within the imperial household. Yet, if they marry outside of the family, they officially lose their status as royalty. Now, being that there are so many daughters within the current imperial family and extended family, they really have no choice other than to remain single their whole life or marry an outsider and lose their royal status. Thus is the story of Princess Mako, who recently went forward with marrying an outsider, an issue that has caused some furious debates in Japan. Once again, most of the concern for this is regarding a controversy surrounding the family of her new husband, but it also brings up the old debate of the dwindling imperial line in Japan, as yet another princess is leaving the imperial family. It raises the topic yet again of should Japan pass succession reform in aims to help female members retain their royal status so that their offspring would inherit it as well. These also tie in with other problems regarding Japan's issue with gender equality, but I'm not going to get into that subject here. Now, in the past, these imperial succession issues have arose with many calling for reform, while others have pushed back on the idea entirely. And back on the topic of Princess Mako in particular, the issue of her becoming a commoner in order to marry has also sparked some debate abroad, where some who see this as an injustice chalk it up to just another reason why the world does not need monarchies anymore, and that royal families like that in Japan should simply be dissolved entirely. But I should mention that those foreigners who believe that often don't understand the historical and cultural significance of the Japanese emperor in the first place as it is. The funny thing about this is that it would not have been much of an issue at all when more of the branches of the imperial family were still considered legitimate and not null and void, following the Imperial Household Law of 1947, which eliminated all other branches. But now, because there are so many daughters within the current imperial family, and realistically, they can't produce proper male offspring due to their inability to stay within the royal family if they were to marry outside of it, it creates a massive problem for how the family will continue on. As of right now, the imperial line is secured for at least another generation or so. The current emperor is Naruhito, who succeeded his father Akihito in 2019 when he retired from the throne. But being that Naruhito only has one child and that she is a daughter, succession will likely pass to his brother, Fumihito, before then continuing on to his only son, the young prince Hisahito. If nothing were to change, Hisahito will need to have sons, and preferably plenty of them, if the imperial Japanese family is to continue. Otherwise, drastic reform will be needed to ensure that the imperial line does not die out. However, I strongly believe we will not get to that point. Being that the emperor is such an important part of Japan, in both its history, culture, and even current identity, I don't ever see the nation simply allowing the imperial line to wither on the vine. If anything, as a last resort, I do feel drastic reform would come if absolutely needed. It is just not really known in what form these reforms would come in. In fact, a recent poll in Japan indicated that over 80% of Japanese citizens said they would readily accept perhaps a female ascending to the throne, or even a male who is descended from just a former female member of the imperial family. With that type of acceptance, I am one to believe that the imperial line will remain safe for some time. But with that said, the real core of what I wanted to talk about here in this video is really why the Japanese emperor is so significant, and why even I as a foreigner believes, with its historical and cultural weight, it should go on. The real meat of it is the fact that it really is the longest running royal bloodline in the world and carries with it a title that, as I mentioned earlier, has been as respected as a monarch and even as worshipped as, say, a pope. To this day, Japan even continues to name its eras after the posthumous names of its emperors, with the current Reiwa era having just started in 2019 with the ascension of Emperor Naruhito. The status of the emperor is so ingrained into the heart and soul of Japan that it is hard, even as a foreigner, to not recognize its great importance. And that is really what I am trying to get across. Once again, I want to make it abundantly clear that this is a complicated subject, and if you find any mistakes I may have made in covering it, please feel free to correct me. But with that said, thank you for watching, and don't forget to like, subscribe, and ring that notification bell if you enjoyed this video and found it to be most interesting.